By the way, my name is Tim Lorden. I'm the Executive Director of the Internet Education Foundation. And thanks. Welcome back. Our next panel is called Innovation.Gov, the Future of Better, Faster, Cheaper Government. Don't go to innovation.gov because the URL doesn't exist at the moment, but we thought it would be a good title for the next panel. I just want to quickly introduce our speakers. We have Matt Lehrer, who's the Senior Advisor for Majority Leader Kevin McCarthy. Nick Sinai, who's with Insight Venture Partners, he's a partner there, and he's also formerly a Deputy Chief Technology Officer in the White House. And moderating today is Ginny Hunt, who's the Director of Platforms for the U.S. Digital Service. So, welcome. Thank you, Ginny.
Great. Thanks so much for having us. We're excited to be here. And I think we'll jump right in with what came down to the wire on Friday is the last piece of work that the President signed on his way out of office, the Talent Act. This is something, Matt and Nick, that both of you worked on extensively over the years. So why don't we jump in and let you tell a bit of that story. So Nick, do you want to get started with a bit of the history, and then Matt, you can give behind the scenes of the last few weeks and hours.
Sure. I'm happy to do so, and thanks for having me here. So the Presidential Innovation Fellows Program was something that a number of us started in 2012. So this really was then CTO Todd Park his brainchild and modeled in part after Code for America and their fellowship program. And working closely with Macon Phillips, with Steve Van Rokel, with Jeff Zients, and a number of agencies as part of an innovation cohort. And the idea is simple. You know, how can we bring talented entrepreneurs and technologists in for a short-term tour of duty, pair them with innovators inside an agency, and get important things done for the American people? And so we started with a small class of under 20 Presidential Innovation Fellows in 2012. And the thing grew and grew very successfully. And Presidential Innovation Fellows have gone on to do all kinds of things from liberating health data via the blue button. They've helped during Hurricane Sandy. They have saved a lot of money and on a bunch of projects. President Obama signed an executive order to help very recently, it looks like President Obama signed bipartisan legislation. And so the real fun story is in the last few weeks. And maybe, Matt, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, and first of all, thanks for having me. This is a community of which I've been proud to be a part of and have learned a great deal of from over the last several years. And in many ways, this act, while not the most substantial piece of legislation to ever pass Congress, is the perfect symbol of the power of this of the technology community to impact policy across the board. So, you're all familiar with the overall political climate that we live in, and that the relationship at times between the administration and the last administration at Capitol Hill wasn't always as in sync as maybe others would have hoped. but nonetheless, this was, again, a symbol of areas where that agreement did exist. It's all around innovation. So, the PIF program has been, I think, a remarkable success. And more importantly, the majority leader feels that way. And so we were looking at ways, and this is well before the election, of how do we show not only the people involved, but the broader executive branch that this is bigger than one president and one party. And so working with, I see some familiar faces in this room that were helping in this process, we got the legislation drafted, which the leader introduced. We got through Congress, or got through the House, we were able to get it through the Senate by UC. And then it was and the incoming administration, the current administration, was very supportive of the legislation as well. But I thought, and I don't think a lot of people felt that it would be a powerful symbol if Barack Obama could sign this legislation, again, to emphasize just how widespread that support is for things, not just the PIF program, but things like it that bring innovation into government. But, there is a bureaucracy, even well-meaning. So even though it was UC'd by the Senate, we had, it has to be enrolled, as some of you I'm sure know, and has to be signed by the Speaker and the President pro tempore, and the whole process has got to be on the right parchment. It's a very analog process. and so that takes a couple days. And the only times when we normally accelerate that process is when the government will be shutting down if we don't. And this didn't quite raise to that level of urgency. But nonetheless, both with, I think, people inside the Congress and people outside from the innovation community, we were able to sort of mobilize, bring people together. And in the final hours of the administration, as President Obama had come to the Capitol, you know, with President-elect Trump at that point, at 11:07 a.m., like in the holding room, as he's about to walk out with his successor, his last act as president, formal act, was to sign this bill into law. So it's kind of this great movie moment of, you know, I've already optioned the movie rights, and I fully, but it was kind of like the end of Argo or something, where it's like this high drama, like, will it get there, we'll get in time. You know, but he got the piece of paper in time, thanks to the great efforts of people, you know, outside, but also I'd like to particularly highlight Clerk of the House, Karen Haas, who was able to move things along very quickly and sign into law. And so as cool as that is, it's like a logistical story. For me, the takeaway, again, is just the power of this community to make change and the enduring nature of that change. And we can talk more about that, I'm sure, in the conversation.
That would be great, and congrats again.
Congrats to everybody.
So taking a step back more broadly, if you look back at the past few years before we start to look forward to the next few years and reflect on what's worked or lessons learned and where you've seen particularly sort of across the aisle and across branches of government how the innovation agenda has been able to move ahead and accelerate, what have you sort of taken away from that that we should learn from?
Yeah, so some of you may be familiar, Leader McCarthy and Chief Deputy Whip Patrick McHenry, about mid last year, started something called the Innovation Initiative, which is kind of, you know, those cheeky DC names, but essentially it was like, how can we find consensus-based, but yet high-impact pieces of legislation that do two things primarily? One is bring innovation into government, and two is foster more innovation in the private marketplace. And in roughly six legislative months, and as you know, the House calendar wasn't exactly, we weren't in every day during that 6 months. We passed 35 bills, two of which became law outright. Several others became, the provisions of which became a law through other pieces of legislation. And the average for those 35 bills was 380 votes out of the House. So, and these were all, whether it's more focused things like talent, but also maybe higher impact things like helping to migrate federal infrastructure to cloud-based infrastructure, or doing things for angel investors from the HALOS Act, or some of you may have worked on ECPA, our email privacy reform, which we got through the House, and I know this year we're optimistic about with the Senate. So there was, but the culture that's being built involves, as much as it involves the leadership of my boss and making sure those bills come to the floor, it also involves the committee chairman in a very, but also the ranking members is the point I'd like to stress. You know, In the floor debate about talent, which again is kind of the symbol, you know, my boss spoke and Will Hurd spoke, who, if you're not familiar with him, I would get to know him and his office. They're incredible allies for innovation in government. But also Steny Hoyer spoke, and several members from the other side of the aisle. So it's a unique opportunity. You know the current political climate. You know the partisan divides that exist in our dialogue and culture. But it's not just talent. I mean, again, 35 bills last year passing the House in 6 months. We've already passed seven this January alone, and we have pretty aggressive plans to move on high-impact but consensus-based bills throughout this session.
That's fantastic. And Nick, if you were to look on the executive branch side over the past few years at what's been accelerated and what's been accomplished, what stood out to you in terms of the agenda?
So much. I had the great privilege of working for President Obama and underneath him, Anish Chopra, Todd Park, and Megan Smith, all three fantastic and charismatic CTOs, and so I'm eager to see a CTO in the new administration. One of the things that Megan Smith talks about is the importance of having tech people in the room, and that's true in tech policy. I know this is mostly a tech policy crowd, and that's where I got my start at the FCC with the National Broadband Plan, but it's also true in service delivery. And it's no longer okay to admit that you don't know anything about tech or just say the IT guys and gals will fix that. And we saw what happened with healthcare.gov. And so you really see with Presidential Innovation Fellows, the U.S. Digital Service, 18F, the Defense Innovation Unit, Experimental, the Health and Human Services Innovation Lab, you see a bunch of really interesting innovation and digital service delivery units that are changing how the federal government delivers services to the American people in profound ways. And so I am just so fired up about the work there. There's a couple hundred people in the U.S. Digital Service between the White House and the 8 agency teams. There's a couple hundred people in the tech transformation 18F, which is a service inside the General Service Administration. And you just look to something like vets.gov, right? Before, veterans had over 1,000 websites to navigate. You had to have a special browser plugin to be able to actually get benefits online. And thanks to Marina Martin, the outgoing CTO, and the VA digital service team that she's built there, just about everyone is a term appointee, and so not a political, and so they'll all stick around. They took the applications from, I think it's 60 to 500. So those are real veterans getting healthcare every day. And so I'm just tremendously optimistic about the opportunity to continue to reform government. We spend almost $90 billion a year in federal IT, and most of it is underperforming and is really not user-centric. I think a lot of these efforts focus on, let's actually bring human-centered design, let's actually understand the user, let's bring the best practices of Silicon Valley, of New York, of Boston, of Austin, Texas. Let's bring these best practices of the tech industry, and that means, you know, let's move to the cloud, let's use modern security, let's be rigorously user-focused. So the last thing that we want to be doing is speccing something out for years and years and years, and then procuring for years and years, and then building. Value of these various efforts, because at the end of the day, they are providing a lot of taxpayer value. They can point to a bunch of projects where they've saved many tens of millions of dollars and taken something that wasn't working and replaced it at a fraction of the cost with either something that they built or something that they bought from the tech industry.
That's great. And looking at how much progress that's been made and how much is happening already and the growth that's occurring, from your perspective, both on the congressional side and with the new administration, how do you think that both sides can leverage the progress that's been made, and what would you put at the top of the agenda as advice for the next administration in the current?
I guess I'll go first. Well,
they're going to listen to you.
Well, they'll listen to you, too. But I think that they have a tremendous opportunity, not only because of this sort of collaborative bipartisan political culture that exists to drive policy outcomes through the political or through the legislative process, but frankly because of the infrastructure that has been built over the last several years. Things like, obviously, the digital service programs, these innovation centers that are massively effective and have attracted incredible high-level people, but also leveraging, you know, making rules changes and finding ways to leverage private sector talent more efficiently, more effectively. You know, when you think about where we are today in terms of capability versus where the executive branch was 8 years ago, because of the work of folks like to my right and many others, you know, the administration has got the foundation built, I think, for a modern government. You know, the concrete's been laid and the, you know, steel bars or whatever have been put in place. And I think they have the opportunity to, you know, kind of build a modern government on that foundation. The optimistic thing, I think, for me to say from my vantage point on the Hill is, again, like it is difficult to exaggerate the depth of support that exists at the member level for programs like this, both from a policy perspective and from a program perspective, just because the results are there. And whether you're coming at it from the perspective that you want to just improve the quality of public services, or you're coming at it from the perspective that you're trying to save taxpayer money, you know, this essentially does both most of the time. And so, you know, it creates a tremendous opportunity for the new administration to leverage that and deliver some amazing outcomes. I mean, the truth is, I guess it's frankly inspiring when you see the people, and I see some of the faces in this room, who are working on these issues. I mean, the current acting director of the USDS is Matt Cutts, who was a former head of the spam team at one of the largest tech companies in the world. And he's not political, but he has, you know, the government doesn't provide stock options. And, you know, yet he is willing to come in and make the process work better. And not just come in and make it work better for, you know, he and his incredible team, but make the whole process work better for, obviously, the citizen, but also for the tech community at large, to be able to make the government look more like what we see in the private marketplace from in terms of user flow and all the rest. So I think the new administration has a tremendous opportunity in this area, and I'm optimistic that they will seize it.
Can I add on to something? So we tend to celebrate the U.S. Digital Service, 18F, the Defense Innovation Unit, X, all of these elite units that bring really high caliber talent in for a year or two. Sometimes they get addicted to making impact and modernizing government and all of those kinds of things. And Ginny, I know you have that background as well. And they are heroes, but I think the other heroes are the career civil servants who are just tremendous innovators who are doing most of the work, frankly. And so it really is the pairing of folks deep inside the agencies, you know, with executive support, so with secretary and deputy secretary support, that absolutely has been critical to the successes that all of these units have had. But it's the pairing with those civil servants who really understand the program, understand the procurement, understand what's been tried in the past, and they have the scars on their back. So when a hotshot team kind of comes, hopefully with radical empathy as well as best practices from the private sector, they're able to pair really well together, and that's when you see the magic, and that's when you see the kinds of things like the college scorecard, like vets.gov, like the Defense Digital Service, which is working on the defense travel system for 3 million people inside the Department of Defense. I mean, that's really the magic of the two things, and I want to make sure that we recognize that they're partners who've been there from the beginning. Things we got right, and there's clearly some things that we tried and failed on, and so I would encourage the new administration to listen to the folks that are sticking around. And the good news is, in the innovation teams, the digital service teams, in a number of places across the administration, folks are sticking around because most of them are not political appointees. And so I really do hope that the new administration seizes this. And of course, they're going to focus on taxpayer value, and that's something that we were focused on as well. We just didn't use that term, but I'm. You know, a modern, effective, efficient government that delivers on its promise using best practices of the tech sector. It's like, how could you be against that? And I think that's why we come from different sides of the aisle, but we work so well together.
So I'd like to have one other piece of advice, I guess, both to the incoming team and to this room. You know, we are in, it's maybe self-evident, but, you know, time is finite. As we said, every moment counts. You know, I'm getting a plaque made that says 11:07 a.m., every minute counts, but the you know, this is a unique opportunity, not only because of the party alignment between the branches, but also whenever you have a new administration and kind of a re-energized Congress, the ability to make big substantive changes, to pass big bills, to stand up big programs and projects, and you know, but it things you know the it's never worth as the car is never worth as much as when you drive it off the lot. So, you know, we've got to take advantage of this new car. I would recommend, both. I know that's our attitude from the Hill, to do some good things and to hopefully deliver the kinds of change-based outcomes that we can all agree on. And then, you know, when the momentum peters out, we'll go back to our squabbling.
So to your point of making every minute matter, we want to be sure that many of you in the room have a chance to do that as well. So if you have questions, we'll begin to open it up for a few questions before we get to the next keynote. So begin to think of those, or if you want to put up your hand, we can begin to ask that. We'll give folks a moment. While folks are thinking of their questions, I think to your point of what weren't you able to get done that you look back and said, if I only had 3 more months, if I only had, you know, X more hours, what you would have looked back and said would have been at the top of your list of
I'll give you a wonky one, but this is a wonky crowd. I teach at the Kennedy School, and I talk about the difference between wonks and hacks, right? And so we definitely have a room of wonks here. So you guys will appreciate this. I think it's far time to modernize the Paperwork Reduction Act, right? And so there's a lot of lofty goals in the Paperwork Reduction Act, right? And you want to minimize paperwork and the burden on the American people. But at the same time, a lot of the processes and the way it's been implemented essentially have proven to be a bit of an impediment around how we design modern digital services that help the American people, whether they're filling out forms online. I mean, we now have wizards that are customized, not with hats, but that are, when you think about forms, it's not about taking a paper form and just putting the digital version. And a lot of the processes that we have in, for example, the White House Office of Information Regulatory Affairs is still focused on how do we approve a paper form, right? And so this is like super in the weeds, but that kind of modernization I think is really important as we are working on delivering services and supporting our active duty troops, supporting the veterans, supporting students, all of the digital services that we are improving, making more user focused. There's gonna be various things like the Paperwork Reduction Act, where I think we could absolutely modernize and make that better. So that's one.
Well, my answer would just be more.
The other thing that I'm super excited about, and it sounds like it's on the House Majority Leader's agenda, according to Matt, is what Tony Scott was working on. So how do we provide the funds for people to invest in modern technology and retire legacy systems? We have systems that are 20, 30, 40, 50-year-old IT systems. It's really impressive and scary at the same time. And you get to know some of the civil servants who are keeping a particular database up in technologies and languages that don't exist anymore today except for that particular thing. And so they're heroes inside the bureaucracy, but it's inefficient, and it's also very expensive. And so I'm hopeful that we'll be able to get some of that done this year.
Questions?
Sure. I'm tempted to ask how many members of the USDS know COBOL after bringing up the legacy issue, but I've got something else to ask about. One of the other legacies of the administration, if we're talking about Innovation.gov, which does not exist as far as I know, is opening up data and code for the American public to use for the purposes of transparency, accountability, participation, and collaboration. And I work at the Sunlight Foundation, so I care about those things. Can you talk about why it's important for the Trump administration to look at the legacy of that and what would come out of it, what the USDS is doing in those areas, and whether Congress is going to act to move the Open Government Data Act forward? The Senate voted unanimously on the 114th in December, but of course, we got a reboot.
I'll start, and then maybe you guys want to jump in. So as Alex knows, I had the great privilege of leading the President Obama's open data initiatives. And my successor, an upgrade, DJ Patel, the first US chief data scientist. I'm proud of all the work that we did in concert with the agencies. We have an executive order making open and machine readable the new default for new government information systems while still protecting privacy. There's a variety of initiatives in health, energy, education, public safety to responsibly take data and make it available to the public wherever possible as fuel for private sector innovation, but also importantly for accountability purposes. And I think, Alex, you've been a leading light on the from Sunlight and as a reporter on this particular topic. And I'm hopeful the new administration also recognizes the importance of open government data for accountability and performance reasons. And I think this doesn't have to always be
about politics, look at the new vets.gov dashboard, and you can see all kinds of performance metrics about how we are delivering services to veterans today. Right? It used to be less than a majority of veterans could actually access services on their smartphones, on their phones. And that's what we all carry around today, including a lot of veterans of the younger generation. And so now 100% can access it. So there's a great dashboard there, and there's a lot of other examples like that. So I'm hopeful that this new administration will recognize that if they want to continue the momentum on effective government, that it's important to have those dashboards about how we are living up to the promises that we've made to the constituents or whoever else that we're delivering services for.
One, I think open data as a category is not just important for the reasons you outlined, but I would add a fifth, which is economic development. If you look at the history of the government providing, traditionally the government has been really lousy at interfaces. They can get them really good for like a blink of a moment in time, but because the technology is changing so quickly, like some of that tends to atrophy. There's exceptions, but that seems to be the rule. But the government has historically been fantastic at data. And you look at, this may be preaching to the choir in some of these, but the government's accumulation and publicly and distribution of the weather data is what makes the Weather Channel and the Weather Bug app and all that possible. Right? They don't maintain global weather networks. That's government data. GPS data is another amazing example of something that is provided and created by the U.S. military, but that becoming an open that data could be used by anybody, in the marketplace. Has created not just an improvement to the quality of life, but a lot of economic value for the United States and for American tech companies around and providing a global marketplace that we can leverage. So we're just at and those are two amazing examples that have created billions in value and countless new jobs and opportunities, and yet they are just the tip of the iceberg for what government data could do, with the right protections and going through all that, but. And, a couple of years ago, the Congress passed and the President signed the Data Act, which deals with spending data, and implementation is well underway, my understanding, at the OMB. And then there's this Open Data Act, which got through the Senate unanimously, and, is definitely being explored. I won't commit to anything, but it's definitely being favorably received at present. But the big principle there is, I think, historically, this has not been a contentious or a partisan issue. And yet it has created enormous value. And you think about what that data could mean in the energy space or healthcare space or transportation space, sky's the limit. There's just a lot of opportunity to provide a more accountable government, a more effective government, but also a lot of economic value for the private sector. The other tail is what you talked about in terms of managing these programs. One of my favorite companies, just on a personal level, is a startup. I won't name them just because they're a startup based in San Mateo, California, and they focus mostly on local governments, and they do spending data dashboards. So you can tell you're talking to maybe that's in the wonk category of things. But what's amazing about these dashboards is that you can cross-tab the information with outcomes. So instead of debating, right now the only metric we have, more or less, that's like a hard number, consistently for everybody, all the time, is did you spend a dollar or did you not spend a dollar? Right. I mean, there's other data points out there, but that's kind of like the one, like universal, truly accepted data point. And as a result, that becomes like the fracture point for so much of our public discourse. But yet, if you actually look at what we're arguing about or why we're arguing or debating about something, many times it's an outcome that we all agree on. And so and it's not always the case, but many times it is. And yet, we get trapped in the fiscal debates for obvious reasons. I think if, and this is more of a long-term, project or hope, if you can create a world in which, and this is what I'm seeing at the local level with platforms like the one I saw out west, the ability to cross-tab the information, almost like you would a digital analytics dashboard, with other, kind of data points. So Veterans Affairs, you're talking wait times per facility, wait times per region, and just matter-of-fact data points, so wait times per dollar spent, or wait times per patient, or wait times per whatever, or recidivism rates, know, so there's all these other potential data points. And right, that data exists. It's just locked in, you know, either non-transparent systems or the systems that don't talk to each other. And so if we can start to liberate that data, I think that creates a world either for the government to provide that kind of cross-tab analysis or the academic or private sector communities to do so and create value. So, and that, in my opinion, long-term, would shift a lot of the public discourse or has the potential to always being about the fiscal, which will always be, of course, an important part of our debates, as it was, I think, the subject of, you know, some recent musicals and things. but also to introduce that other layer of saying, well, okay, so we both want to reduce, you know, a social problem or an ill or harm, and, oh, this program over here is actually doing that more efficiently, so let's put more resources into that program because we know it's working tangibly, and potentially, you know, being able to see those outcomes in, not necessarily real time, but very in a much faster timeline. One of the frustrations I can say, and my boss has shared this story, so I'm comfortable sharing it, is, and I'll remove the agency name just because I'm even more diplomatic than my boss. but he was meeting with the head of an agency. Just kind of a checkup, right? And as you can imagine, if in the position of majority leader, you often get sort of the chef's tour of how things are going. And so he's meeting with the agency head. Everything's great. This is an amazing year. We're doing awesome. 2 weeks later, they come in and say, we need a huge, like, multi, you know, nine-figure bailout or we're going to shut down. And it's like, well, 2 weeks ago, you said there weren't any problems. And I don't know if that's because the agency head didn't know or if it's just because they were playing politics or whatever. But the reality is you can imagine a world where the public and policymakers have access to some of these real-time dashboards to see not only how money is being spent, but how effectively the outcomes are being delivered. And that all begins with data. So that might be a generational thing in terms of implementation, for all we know, but the foundation of that is going to get this data out there. And the support from the Hill from it, it's been very strong for the five reasons we talked about.
I think we'll see it a lot faster. These things, we often think about technology linearly, but it's actually exponentially sometimes. And so I think we will see more real-time data, whether it's on performance or spending, in various pockets of government even this year.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I would say, you know, from those inside, I think the view that building or delivering services that improve people's lives starts with fundamental openness and what's working, how they're being served, whether that's open source code, to data, to clarity of outcomes. So I'd agree with all of that. And it looks like we are now just at time. So if those have questions, we'll be around afterwards. But thanks to both of you. Thanks to all in the room who've been a part of creating, driving, and building upon innovation agendas across all branches of government at all levels. And we're excited to see what's next. So thanks for the time today.
Thank you.